Legal Scholar Academy welcomes Professor Francis Boyle, who teaches law at University of Illinois, and we are very pleased to talk to him about a number of things, particularly about international law, about self-determination movements, particularly in Palestine, Hawaii, and Puerto Rico. We're going to also talk about 9/11 and the Guantanamo prison. And finally, I'm going to ask Professor Boyle about his views on legal education in the United States. So, Professor Boyle, welcome to Legal Scholar Academy. And I would like you to tell us briefly about yourself.
Well, thank you for having me here, Ali. My best to your listening audience. My career in the law started in the summer of 1959 when I was 9 years old. And my father, after whom I am named, decided to set up his own law practice as a trial lawyer, plaintiff's litigator, in downtown Chicago. So he put me into our 1955 green Chevy, which is the first car he ever bought, and brought me along to move his files from his old firm there, Morgan, Halligan, and Lanoff, to his own firm, Francis A. Boyle, attorney at law, at 11 South LaSalle Street, Suite 1707. And he duly appointed me the clerk for his law firm. And what that meant then was that I spent all summer vacations and school holidays running around downtown Chicago and delivering errands and messages and this, that, and the other thing. So it was a real experience. Now, if I had done that to my 9-year-old sons, they'd take them away.
Yeah.
this was a different era.
What kind of law he practiced?
Well, my dad was a plaintiff's litigator.
Okay.
So he always stood up for the little guy.
Yes.
In the world.
And so you think that influenced the way you look at the world?
Well, of course. And my mother saw the world the exact same way. So I always saw my dad, you know, going into court or meeting with clients, and they were just the little people of the world. They were not, you know, the big, wealthy, powerful. Whatever. And, you know, to be honest, he made a very successful practice. I didn't grow up in poverty or anything like that. I want to make it clear. My dad did, but I didn't.
Yeah.
So I had a unique childhood. I was surrounded by lawyers and judges and politicians of the Dick Daley machine. My dad was Irish-American. He knew Daley and all the rest of them, went to school with them, fought in the Marine Corps with them all. So I knew all of them. And so it was a very unique type of childhood.
Where did you go to law school?
Harvard Law School. I started there in 1971. It was, if you've seen the movie The Paper Chase, that's exactly what Harvard Law School was like. The fellow who wrote that was a few years ahead of me. And the Kingsfield in The Paper Chase is modeled on my old contracts teacher, Phil Arita. Mm-hmm. So that's exactly what Harvard Law School was for the 3 years I was there. Although, in fairness, I got an excellent legal education. There's no question about it that even though it was pretty tough,
yes.
No question. Nevertheless, I came out and hit the ground running. So
now, Professor Boyle, are you teaching at University of Illinois now? And what do you teach?
I started here in August of 1978. I've taught many courses over the years, but right now, my package for the last several years has been public international law, international human rights, the constitutional law of U.S. foreign affairs, and jurisprudence.
Okay.
So that's my basic package right now. But I've taught Latinos in the law, criminal law, international organizations, world politics and international law, many other courses. But that's been my package now for a while.
So what would be your definition of international law? Because there's a lot of skepticism about the jurisprudence of international law, including its existence, its enforcement, the discrimination among nation states. So what is your view of international law?
Right. Well, of course, there's good grounds for skepticism. I also have a PhD in political science from Harvard in international relations, and I went through the same program that produced Henry Kissinger before me, and they gave me Kissinger's old office there at the Center for International Affairs. So I even wrote a poem about that one. I could send it to you sometime.
Okay.
Interesting.
Yeah.
But the bottom line is, sure, I was educated there to believe that international law was completely irrelevant to anything. But that's not the way I ever saw it. And indeed, I have tried, in my own career to promote international law. For example, all the work I've done for the Palestinians, tell the Palestinians international law is irrelevant. That's the one thing they really have going for them. And I was the one who recommended in 1987 at the United Nations that they unilaterally proclaim their own state and then move forward to UN membership. And I did all the legal work for them on that project, including the Declaration of Independence. And today, Palestine is now de jure recognized by 135 states, Sweden 2 weeks ago. And now you're seeing all the European parliaments saying our government should recognize them. I'm sure those last kingpins will fall very soon.
But don't you think, Professor Boyle, that still the powerful states like the United States, China, Russia, they still have disproportionate power and the ability to violate international law if they wish to do so?
That's correct. I mean, look at the poor Palestinians. They're up against both Israel, which is one of the most powerful countries in the world, and also against the United States. And yet on November 29, 2012, Palestine was recognized by the United Nations General Assembly as a UN observer state. Now, it took us 25 years to get there, fighting by means of international law, but we're there. And indeed, I've worked it out so Palestine can get admitted to the United Nations itself as a UN member state, despite Obama's threat of a veto by invoking the Uniting for Peace resolution. So what you're saying is correct, that very powerful states don't pay all that much attention to international law. But the poor, the oppressed, the downtrodden of the world, that's one source of power they really have. Again, to give another example drawn from my own practice, in December of 1991, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, the Bush senior administration accused Libya of the Lockerbie bombings, which Libya had nothing to do with. Everyone knows that. It was purely political. And then mobilized the Sixth Fleet off the coast of Libya to attack them, to bomb them. And to head that off, I filed lawsuits at the World Court on behalf of Libya against both the United States and the United Kingdom. I demanded an immediate hearing by the court and provisional measures of protection on behalf of Libya against the U.S. and the U.K. And what happened? Bush Sr. ordered the Sixth Fleet to stand down. Mm. There's no attack on Libya. No one died. And eventually the whole Lockerbie matter was resolved in a peaceful, nonviolent manner way using international law. And I discussed this in my book, my latest book on Libya, Destroying Libyan World Order. I have a whole chapter in there entitled Resolving the Lockerbie Dispute by Means of International Law.
So wonderful. Then you would say that international law is a force, particularly in favor of poor countries and weak countries. this is the weapon they can fight with the strong countries, because otherwise they don't have anything else going for them.
That's correct. I mean, look at what my teacher, mentor, and friend Abe Chase did in the Nicaragua case. Abe was a friend of mine, Harvard Law School. I was not involved in the Nicaragua case at the World Court, but he won the provisional measures of protection. He then won the judgment on jurisdiction, and then he won a final judgment on the merits. That was 1986. And then at that point, Bush Sr. decided to wind the war down against Nicaragua. And I was involved here in the United States in my book, Defending Civil Resistance Under International Law. I was involved in large numbers of criminal and civil cases opposing the Reagan war against Nicaragua, and using those World Court proceedings that Abe Chase had filed and won.
You see, so, it's very interesting that I was talking to Professor Alan Dershowitz, and I asked him about the International Court of Justice, and he said they're a bunch of thugs. And particularly, you know, he was referring to the Israeli wall case. And he was so mad at the judges and had very harsh words to say about them. So I think it's good to hear you that you have a very respectful and hopeful a view of the International Court of Justice.
Well, look, Dershowitz has always been that way. He was an assistant professor there when I started as a 1L. And his great claim to fame was representing pornographers and pornography, Harry Reams and all that. And as Catherine McKinnon has taught us all, you know, pornography is a form of violence against women. But with respect to Dershowitz's attack on the World Court in the Wall case, what Dershowitz does not know or care about is that the American judge at that time was Tom Bergenthal. Yes. Tom's a friend of mine. He was ahead of me at Harvard Law School. He got his LLM and SJD at Harvard Law School. He was in there, and he condemned the Israeli settlements for violating the Fourth Geneva Convention. Well, Tom Bergenthal is a Holocaust survivor. He's Jewish, extraction from Czechoslovakia. And when he was a young boy, he was put into a Nazi concentration camp. And eventually he came here to the United States and made it up to the World Court. And despite this background, Tom was principled enough and courageous enough to rule that those settlements violated the Fourth Geneva Convention. Well, that should tell you everything you need to know about Alan Dershowitz attacking a Holocaust survivor. He also attacked Israel Shahak, a friend of mine, another Holocaust survivor, a leader of the peace movement in Israel, unfortunately no longer with us, and even Norman Finkelstein's mother,
yes,
another Holocaust survivor that Dershowitz attacked. So, I think that's pretty pathetic that Dershowitz attacking Holocaust survivors. But again, to his credit, and all of us who knew know Tom Bergenthal knew that, you know, he's a very principled man, and I didn't expect anything differently from Tom in that ruling on the wall.
Right.
So, if you want to discredit that case, you're going to have to discredit Tom Bergenthal. And I don't know any international lawyer, human rights lawyer, who in the United States would do that. Remember, Dershowitz has no expertise in international law or human rights.
That's true. I think it was very clear talking to him that he had very, you know, lay view of international law.
Right. Well, I debated him, and during the course of this debate, he admitted I was the expert.
Yeah.
Well, why would you debate someone and concede that your adversary is the expert on the subject you're supposed to be debating? It's not very smart either. But, I guess, I regret to report Alan, I've known him for many years, and he doesn't particularly like me, and he's condemned me in his books. But, I regret to say there are, unfortunately, many American Jewish law professors who have a very difficult time being objective when it comes to Israel and its dispute with the Palestinians. Tom Bergenthal was not one. Louis Sohn, who taught both Tom and me at Harvard Law School, Louis was not that way at all. And Louis, you know, very explained to our students what were the rights of the Palestinians and, you know, how they had been validated.
But I regret. So what do you, Professor Boyle, what do you see is going to happen to the two-state solution in Palestine and Israel?
It doesn't look very good right now between you and me. I really don't know. I've given the best advice, you know, to the Palestinians I can. I still advise them. My current advice, it's a matter of public record, so I'm not revealing any attorney-client confidences here, is that they should invoke the Uniting for Peace resolution and go for United Nations member state status, and then give me the authority to sue Israel at the International Court of Justice. And they threatened this. Hanan Ashwari has threatened both steps. Saab Erekat, their top negotiator, has threatened both steps. What happens, I really don't know. In the next 10 days or so, they will be introducing a resolution at the Security Council. They're working very hard to get the Obama administration not to veto it. I'm sort of plan B, that if he does veto it, they have other steps they can take. So I just don't know what they're going to do.
But so even if there is a Palestinian state, do you believe that it's going to be viable and it's going to, you know, prosper when Israel, who's so skeptical of the Palestinians, is right there?
The state will have to be set up in such a way that they have genuine independence. Yes, and you have to understand, no, the Palestinians are the most highly educated people in the Arab world because they're a diaspora people. So they all understand the value of education. So they're highly educated, highly motivated. Many of them are merchants and traders, engineers, regretfully, not as many lawyers as I would have liked over the years, but yes. More lawyers coming along.
Yes.
So I think they can make a go of it. Plus, you have these massive gas deposits there in the Mediterranean, right off the coast of Gaza. And the Palestinians are entitled to their fair share of those gas deposits. So I think if, you know, there's enough there to make a state go if that's what happens. But I, you know, I'm afraid that, you know, if things keep going the way they are, you know, we're going to be into a one-state solution. But that is not the current Palestinian position. I was there at the beginning in 1987, 88, when they officially adopted the two-state solution and abandoned the one-state solution. When I was working with them, I started working with them in 1982, their official position was that there should be one state in the entire mandate of Palestine that should be secular and democratic. Now, in the Palestinian Declaration of Independence, I was the legal advisor on that. Chairman Arafat himself put into that declaration the acceptance of the partition resolution 181, calling for two states in order to promote peace with Israel.
Yeah.
But as President Abbas has said, we could be at the end of the two-state solution and the Palestinians going back to a one-state solution. But I want to make clear that is not their official position.
Yes.
President Abbas has said Israel is putting us into this situation. Hanan Ashwari also. Hanan is now the first woman on the PLO executive committee that serves as the provisional government for the state of Palestine. She said the same thing, that we might be seeing the end of the two-state solution. You know, it's really up to Obama. Is he going to sit on the Israelis or not? And right now, I don't see any evidence he's going to do this.
Yeah, I think my view is that eventually it's going to be one state. I think two-state solution is simply not sustainable given, you know, the all the factors that make the soup. But anyway,
I want to point out for the record, though, that from 1987 until now, today, the Palestinians, and I've worked with them, have done everything humanly possible to promote a two-state solution. And it is Israel, consistently, since 1987, when I first proposed this idea to them, until today when we speak under Netanyahu, that has opposed the two-state solution, because they want all of Palestine, all of it, and they want as few Palestinians as possible.
That's true.
That's been their objective going back to the Baal Conference in 1897 of the Zionist movement. All of Palestine and as few Palestinians as possible. But the Palestinians have tried. And if they finally say we're giving up, if that's the vote by the PLO Executive Committee and President Abbas, I'll certainly respect it, because I've tried with them for all these years, and we've gotten nowhere.
Absolutely. Now, let me ask you more broadly, that do you think the process of decolonization has successfully been completed, or we still have some residual work that needs to be done?
Well, it hasn't been completed at all, no. I think most of it, as we've seen in Africa and Asia, has been very successful. And I studied all these at Harvard Law School with Chase and Sohn and Baxter. Clyde Ferguson was my human rights teacher. Very fortunate I took Clyde's first course. So I studied this entire decolonization process. And then when I came here, I got involved in many of these issues. So it's been a phenomenal success. But we still have, you know, some issues out there, like the Palestinians, like Puerto Rico, like the Kanaka Maoli, the Native Hawaiians, whom I work with. So there are, as you correctly point out, Kashmir. Still, as you know, there's a General Assembly resolution saying the Kashmiris are entitled to a vote on self-determination.
Actually, there are Security Council resolutions as well, but they're not under Chapter 7, they're Chapter 6.
Right.
So yes, I think it seems like, but on the other hand, why is it that the South Sudanese and Timorese in Indonesia, they were quick to get their right to self-determination, but when it comes to Muslim communities, whether they're Palestinians or Kashmiris or others, they have very hard time actualizing their right to self-determination?
Well, of course, on South Sudan, the United States promoted the civil war in Sudan against the Muslim government there, and armed, equipped, and supplied the South Sudanese, and then brokered their independence. And I think that can account for South Sudan. Now, on the East Timorese, no, that was a very long struggle. It was Kissinger and Ford who gave Suharto the green light to invade East Timor. I believe that's about 1976. And over the years, you had close to 200,000 East Timorese exterminated out of a population of 600,000. It's outright genocide, one third right there. And only in the last round of genocide, under the Clinton administration, this is publicly reported, I cited it in one of my books, Clinton called up Suharto and ordered him to get out of East Timor immediately, or the United States government would cut off all forms of economic assistance to Indonesia, not just by the United States bilaterally, but the World Bank, the IMF, everything else would be completely cut off. So at that point, Suharto left. But that was a very long struggle there. But you are right. If we're looking around the world today, the United States and Israel are targeting Muslims all over the world. They've destroyed Iraq as a state. They've destroyed Afghanistan as a state. They've destroyed Libya as a state. They've destroyed Syria as a state. Lebanon exists only in name. This goes back to Wolfowitz, the Deputy Secretary of Defense under Bush Jr., where after 9/11 he said the United States is going to get into the business of destroying states. And then that was confirmed by General Wesley Clark in his memoirs. He visited the Pentagon there in, I think it was November of 2001, and was told, yes, the neocons had drawn up a list of seven Muslim states to be destroyed. They've destroyed Syria. You know, Iran is still standing. So it, you know, and I have the citation for that in my book.
Do you think that Pakistan is also on the list?
Yes, I think that the AFPAC war was designed, as conceived by Bush and his neocons, was designed to destabilize Pakistan. Yes, I think if you look at it, everything going on over there, the drone strikes, the destabilization, I believe the consistent pattern of the neocons is to crack up these states.
And denuclearize, probably denuclearize Pakistan also.
Right, and especially since Pakistan has nuclear weapons, the yes. so-called Islamic bomb.
Right.
So I think the consistent agenda of the neocons going back to the Bush Jr. administration was really to promote instability in Pakistan, which they have very successfully done, as you know, all over Pakistan, especially in the border with Afghanistan. In order to create instability, crack Pakistan up into its ethnic and religious units, and then somewhere in there to neutralize Pakistan's nuclear weapons establishment.
So do you think this whole thing is anti-Islamic, or it is just to destabilize a few Muslim countries so that, you know, the geopolitical situation is more favorable to Israel and the United States?
I think it's both. Again, look at the victims here since 9/11, 2001. They're almost all Muslim states and Muslim peoples.
Right.
Look at the drone strikes over there in Pakistan. Who is Obama murdering? They're all Muslims, or Yemen.
Yeah.
So I think what we're seeing here, certainly under the Bush Jr. administration, the neocons, they're all Zionists. I went to college with them at the University of Chicago, where the neoconservative movement was founded by Leo Strauss. Wolfowitz was there ahead of me studying international relations, getting his PhD when I was getting my bachelor degree. So yeah, they want to take apart Muslim states as they see it, not only for the United States interest to reorder the world, but also on behalf of Israel as well.
Very briefly, Professor Boyle, what do you think of Islamic State?
I've already been quoted as saying I believe that's a covert U.S. intelligence operation. And indeed, I know Senator Rand Paul has basically said the same thing to me, independently of me. It's clear that these people have been armed, equipped, supplied, and trained by the United States, Turkey. Many of them were moved from Libya into Turkey. That's why you had the disaster there at Benghazi. That was a CIA operation to channel fundamentalist fighters as well as weapons, equipment, and supplies against the Assad government in Syria, again, to destroy the Assad government, because both Assad's father and son refused to give up the Golan Heights, which both the United States and Israel were demanding that they effectively do, not all of it, but a good chunk of it, especially on the lake there. And the Syrian position had always been, we'll give Israel peace on the same lines that Israel gave peace to Egypt, full peace for full withdrawal. Israel never wanted to do that. And so Assad has been, the Assad government, both father and son have been targeted. So if you look at these ISIS fighters, they've all had advanced training on sophisticated U.S. Weapon systems. It was just reported the supply line goes through Turkey. So I think this is, and many of their leaders were captured by the United States government and probably turned into agents for the United States government. And so I think that's what ISIS is really all about.
But if that is true, then how do we account for beheadings of Western journalists and others?
Oh, sure. These are propaganda stunts to turn... to give perfect propaganda, warmongering types of displays that they can be shown here in the United States and Britain and Europe to whip up warmongering against Iraq and Syria. That doesn't mean all the people down the line understand that at the end of the day, at the top of the food chain is the CIA and the Pentagon. Indeed, we know for a fact the CIA has been over there training these people, and the Pentagon has a base in Jordan that has been training these people. Yes. So this is propaganda stunts designed to give Obama and the British certainly pretext to pursue now their war in Iraq and also in Syria. And in Syria, the ultimate objective still is to destroy the Assad government. And this is going to lead to outright genocide against the Alawites and the Christians for sure.
Yeah. Now, coming back to the United States, how do you see the future of Puerto Rico and Hawaii?
Right. Well, I was just out in the UN Decolonization Committee for the Puerto Ricans arguing their case for independence. I think I sent you my statement this morning.
Yes, I got it.
And I think eventually Puerto Rico will be independent. I also gave a lecture last year down there in Puerto Rico. And, you know, the United States, I think, wants to figure out how to get rid of Puerto Rico because they're not going to make Puerto Rico a state of the union. Mm-hmm. One, Puerto Ricans are brown and black. Second, they speak Spanish, not English. Third, they're Catholic, not Protestant. And fourth, you know, most of them are pretty nationalistic. So I don't see Congress ever voting to give Puerto Rico, to make them the 51st state in the Union. And indeed, they shut down the Roosevelt Roads Naval Station down there several years ago because of heroic protests by the Puerto Ricans at Vieques. I worked on some of those cases.
But is there, is there a strong sentiment among Puerto Ricans to be independent?
Well, you know, if you take some votes that are clearly stage managed, it doesn't come out that way. But, you know, I think at the end of the day, if they had a fair choice, the answer would probably be yes. But I think it's simply a question of time because everyone agrees Puerto Rico is a colony. This gets back to your point on decolonization.
Right.
That's why Puerto Rico is still on the agenda of the Decolonization Committee.
Yes.
Statehooders say, yes, Puerto Rico's a colony. The enhanced Commonwealth people say, yes, Puerto Rico's a colony. The independistas say, Puerto Rico is a colony. So the situation is unsustainable. And now that the U.S. has shut down Roosevelt Roads, they use that base to control and dominate the entire and intimidate the entire Caribbean basin and secure access to the Panama Canal. But that's all gone. So I think, you know, at the end of the day, Puerto Rico will be independent.
And what about Hawaii?
I work with the independistas, and I've worked with them, going back to the FALN case up in Chicago, and I think it was 1979. There's a big Puerto Rican community up in Chicago I've been close with, my family, for many years. So I've worked with them for a long time, and I was just down there twice in the last 2 years dealing with these particular issues. And then in June out in, they asked me to go out and argue the case for independence at the Decolonization Committee. So I think it's coming.
And you foresee that it will become an independent state?
Yes.
Okay. What about Hawaii?
By the way, on Palestine, You know, when I first called for the independence of the Palestinians at in my speech at United Nations headquarters in 1987, Professor Ibrahim Abu-Lagut, who was one of Arafat's top people here in the United States, was sitting next to me, and he stared at me like I was a little green man that had just descended from Mars on a space saucer.
Well,
and yet, here we were 25 years later, being recognized as an observer state by the United Nations with de jure recognition by 135 states. And the Palestinians can have a full-fledged UN membership whenever they want it. Despite Obama's veto, I've set this up for them, and they know it. So what they do, I don't know. So, you know, I've been involved in independence processes, and I think Puerto Rico is very close.
Okay.
Hawaii, I've worked with the Native Hawaiians, the Kanaka Maoli, since 1992. It's a very difficult situation out there. There are only 200,000 of them living out there. And like American Indians here in the United States, they just have these terrible demographic statistics on, you know, alcoholism, crime, diabetes, lack of education, you go on through and through. And large numbers of them have to live out on beaches because they're homeless. So it's a tough situation for them. I was just out there lecturing on my new book, Restoring the Kingdom of Hawaii. I was a guest of the Office of Hawaiian Affairs. They have a convention coming up in 2015, which is why I wrote this book. I sent you the flyer on it. And the advice I gave, and I just sent you my speech on it too, I believe, was that all 135,000 of them eligible to go to this convention should go and vote to restore the Kingdom of Hawaii and then set up a provisional government of national unity for it, and then we'll proceed from there. Because if 135,000 Kanaka Maoli vote to restore the Kingdom of Hawaii, I don't see how anyone in the world can possibly deny their will.
And so, I think it seems like at your heart, you are a force of decolonization and independence and freedom for the people you think have been possessed and occupied.
Yes, I learned this especially, well, you know, I'm Irish American, so look what we've done. I mean, my grandfather, Terence Boyle, was a farmer and a poet, and a great poet, but he also joined the Irish Republican Army to expel the British from Ireland. So that is correct. Irish are admired all over the world because we launched the first successful national liberation war of the 20th century.
Yeah.
Now, we still have six counties left to go.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's only a question of time, too. You know, the British don't want to stay in Ireland. So we'll keep working on that.
Yeah, very good. Now, turning the topic a little bit to 9/11, you have very unique views about 9/11. I think I would like to hear them again.
Well, again, I don't think I have unique views in the sense that Richard Falk has been on the top of 9/11, not me. I was involved in the anthrax attacks of October 2001. I had drafted the Biological Weapons Anti-Terrorism Act of 1989, which is the U.S. domestic implementing legislation for the Biological Weapons Convention that was adopted unanimously by both houses of Congress and signed into law by President Bush Sr. And it was clear to me, and I said so at the time repeatedly in interviews, those anthrax attacks, that was super weapons grade anthrax that had to have been manufactured by scientists working for the United States government at a United States government lab. And later on, that proved to be correct. I have argued that I think what we saw with 9/11 was a 1-2 punch against the Republic. I think, I've argued this in my book, Biowarfare and Terrorism, that there's a good chance the same people behind the anthrax attacks were ultimately behind 9/11. But again, I leave, you know, it's really Professor Falk who in my profession has sort of been in the vanguard of 9/11 itself. It's clear we were not told the truth about what happened on 9/11. I mean, if you read the 9/11 Commission report, it's a total whitewash and a cover-up. And even some of the members of the 9/11 Commission now will say that. So we don't know really what happened, who was behind this. Now, you know, Professor Falk has taken a more affirmative position than I have on that, and that's fine. But I have taken certainly the position that the anthrax attacks, those were designed to shut down the government, get the USA Patriot Act passed, and turn the country into a police state. That's the position I've certainly taken, yes.
Okay, all right. So what future of Guantanamo do you see? I mean, is it going to just linger like that, or are they going to close it? Essentially, it's a Muslim prison for Muslims, because every inmate is a Muslim over there.
Of course, and this goes back to the anti-Muslim policy that the United States government has been pursuing since 9/11/2001. Indeed, right when Bush set up Gitmo, I gave an interview, you know, to the New York Times, just saying it clearly violates the Geneva Convention. And later on, of course, the U.S. Supreme Court agreed with me in the Hamdan decision. I also gave an interview to Tehran Times saying, you know, these Muslims are being treated like dogs in a kennel. And that went out all over here in the United States, and I was even attacked by Rush Limbaugh for that, which I thought was quite funny. But it's clear that it's anti-Muslim. It's been condemned by the United States Supreme Court. It violates the Geneva Conventions. It violates the Uniform Code of Military Justice. You know, the Supreme Court has pointed this out in the Hamdan decision. It's really there to terrify and intimidate the Muslim world, and to say to the Muslim world, you know, this is the way we're going to treat you if you don't do what we tell you.
Yeah.
Likewise, the drone strikes. Who are all the victims of the drone strikes? Muslims.
Yeah.
Well,
absolutely.
They're all Muslims. We now
whether
have
Yemen, Somalia, Pakistan, yeah.
Right, and we now have at least 5,000 murdered Muslims. As a result of the drone strikes, and no end in sight. Now, as for Gitmo, yes, I've given advice down there. I have advised defense counsel down there over the years. Obama can shut down Gitmo if he wants to. Now, there is a statute saying he can't bring these people into the United States. Well, I think they should be tried in Article III court, but if Congress is going to prevent that, then under the Geneva Conventions, there is a procedure for transfer. Namely, Obama could, and Obama was after me at Harvard Law School, so, you know, I don't think he specialized in international law, but he could, if he wanted to, transfer the men at Gitmo under the Geneva Conventions to another party of the Geneva Conventions. For example, Switzerland, which is sort of the supervisory power, as it were, for the Geneva Conventions, provided that Switzerland applies to the Geneva Conventions. And I have recommended this down there on Guantanamo to the defense lawyers, namely that we say to Obama, transfer these men to Switzerland under the Geneva Conventions, and then let the Swiss sort it out. Namely, let's assume, you know, unfortunately the war in Afghanistan is still going on, and so the Swiss might decide, okay, some of these fighters cannot be returned to Afghanistan. They will resume the conflict. So we will detain them here in Switzerland under the terms of the Geneva Conventions, which is not being applied to Gitmo. Gitmo is a hellhole. There's no question about it. Clear-cut violation of the Geneva Conventions right from the beginning, the way these men are being treated, like dogs in a kennel. But Switzerland could say, all right, we believe some of these fighters will return to battle in Afghanistan. We'll detain them here. Others need to be freed right away. We'll free them and repatriate them as required by the Geneva Conventions. Others are alleged to have committed war crimes. Well, we'll look into that, and if that's true, we'll prosecute them.
You think this is going to happen before President Obama leaves, or?
I regret to say no. All I can do, though, is to say legally it is possible for this to be done. Okay. If Obama wants to do it.
He can do it.
An honors graduate of Harvard Law School, he can do it. But I've never gotten a call. I mean, I met Obama here when he came to speak, the black student.
Yeah, he's from your state.
Yeah, I mean, Obama knows who I am. Yes. But, you know, he's not going to call me on anything, so right. Fine. But clearly it can be done if he wants to be done. You know, these are nothing but kangaroo court proceedings. They're a joke and a fraud. They're an insult to the American Constitution and due process of law. It's appalling that you have law professors like Goldsmith or Wedgwood or other trying to defend these kangaroo court proceedings. And what is very dangerous about Gitmo is several of these men face the death penalty.
Yes.
If they are ever executed down there, America will have its first Nazi death camp. There's no other word for it. They'll be processed and murdered.
Yes.
And this will be the equivalent of a Nazi death camp. And I think that's why all of us have to get Gitmo shut down. And I'm not in favor of a Gitmo North. That is, you know, this idiot Goldsmith at Harvard Law School. Let's set up a Gitmo North. Let's bring them up here to Illinois. Well, no, we don't want to import Gitmo here into the United States to pervert our tighter legal system here.
And Gitmo is not just a geographical concept.
No, that you're correctly right. It is, this is legal nihilism, what Gitmo is all about. And kangaroo courts, and all these men have been tortured and abused, and torture violates the Geneva Conventions. It's a war crime.
Yes. Okay, we are running out of time, Professor Boyle. The last topic that I would like to talk about with you is legal education. You have such tremendous experience of educating lawyers. How many lawyers you have taught over the years?
It's probably approaching 4,000.
4,000, yeah.
So, I call it Boyle's Brigade.
Yes. So what do you think, how legal education has changed during your, you know, time in teaching?
Terrible. You know, when I went to law school, Harvard Law School, 1971, the Warren Court had just ended. And so many of us, even at Harvard Law School, which is a pretty mercenary place between you and me, nevertheless saw law because of the Warren Court as a tool to promote progressive change in America and to make America a better place for the poor, the oppressed, the downtrodden, due process of law for everyone. And yet what we've seen is legal education move far to the extreme right, even before 9/11, 2001. First, you had the law and economics movement by Posner at the University of Chicago Law School. I was an undergraduate at the University of Chicago. Milton Friedman was there, his market fundamentalism, the Chicago boys, rape, rob, loot, plunder, and pillage people all over the world. And all Posner did was take Friedmanite market economics, market fundamentalism, and apply it to the law. That's what law and economics is all about. There's nothing progressive about it. Indeed, Posner, I interviewed at the University of Chicago Law School. He didn't particularly like me. But as you know, he now openly espouses torture. And of course, notice all these people who support torture, like Posner, Goldsmith, Dershowitz, Volokh. They're torturing Arab and Muslim men of color.
Yes.
Right? It's very clear what's going on. So I think Posner, the founder of the movement of law and economics at the University of Chicago when I was there, openly advocating torture, tells you what this movement is all about. Then came, and that's, as you know, that's gone all over legal education. Then came the Federalist Society, and even Bob Bork, the founder of the Federalist Society, who, by the way, attacked me in a mass mailing letter to all 25,000 Feddies, as I call them, said publicly, well, now that we've taken over the federal judiciary, we have to move to take over the law schools. And that has happened too. It's happened here, it's happened everywhere, where you have you know, extreme right-wing reactionary positions taken across the board by Federal Society faculty members. All those two motions, Law and Economics, Federal Society, were going on before 9/11/2001. And then along came 9/11/2001, and what do we have? Law professors advocating torture. It's amazing to me. I went to Harvard Law School during the darkest days of the Vietnam War. Not one of my professors ever advocated torture or kangaroo courts or murder or executions or anything like that. And yet you see it all over American law schools today. Harvard, Yale, taking back Harold Killer Cole, Mr. Droner, who was behind me at Harvard Law School. Harvard Law School is hopeless. It's a neocon cesspool these days. Look at what just happened at Northwestern Law School. When I was growing up there in downtown Chicago as a young boy, I had a high opinion of Northwestern Law School. And yet, as you know, their new dean, Rodriguez, invited Attorney General Eric Holder to come out to Northwestern Law School deliberately to justify his policy of drone murder of U.S. citizens, right? And use Northwestern Law School as a prop to justify what was clearly a lawless, illegal, criminal policy. And when Holder showed up at Northwestern Law School, everyone knew what he was going to say, and before he spoke, they gave him a standing ovation.
Wow.
And the only guy to dissent was Professor Margulies, who refused because he represents a guy down in Gitmo. And then after he gave this speech justifying murdering U.S. citizens, he was given a second standing ovation. And I've written about this. So, I mean, it just shows you how perverse and perverted legal education certainly has become after 9/11/2001, when large numbers of professors openly and publicly support torture, kangaroo courts, drone strikes, murder, et cetera. Again, Dershowitz is one of the worst.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's all over legal education these days.
So you think that legal education is now serving the empire?
Of course. Under the Warren Court, and it was not. But these days, yes, legal education has become a handmaiden, a tool for the American empire, and also against the American people, because we see these law and economics professors, these Federalist Society professors, taking totally reactionary positions, even against our own people.
Yes. Now, Professor Boyle, what in teaching these views to your students in international law, international human rights, do you get any reaction? Because some of these students might very strongly disagree with you, because after all, they also want to be part of the empire.
Well, I think you're right, but all my courses are voluntary. None of them are required.
I see. So they
points are well known, Next semester, I have 30 students signed up for human rights, which I put into this curriculum here many years ago against a lot of faculty opposition, but I got it into the curriculum. And in fact, I also taught human rights at Harvard College. I think I was the first person ever to teach human rights in, to undergraduates at Harvard. So, you know, the students know what they're getting in for with my viewpoints. I mean, you can just Google my name and you'll see my viewpoints all over everything on everything. So,
yes, yes.
But they still sign up. This semester, I think I had 23 or 4 students in international law. When I came here, the guy before me had 17. What can I say?
Well, I think I, as you know, I am your admirer, and I think I truly admire your courage and your honesty and sincerity and transparency. And I think these are the qualities that are becoming extinct in education, including legal education. So I have always admired you, and you know that, you know.
Well, thank you.
And so thank you very, very much.
Well, I think you're right, because you see, my teachers at Harvard Law School, they had all come back from World War II and had all decided to themselves there had to be a better way. And that was law and human rights, constitutional law. I had the late, great Paul Freund. You know, Freund, I, could you imagine Paul Freund advocating kangaroo courts in Guantanamo?
Yeah.
Of course not. And so even though Harvard Law School, the legal education was like Kingsfield in the paper chase, still I had a group of men, and back in those days they only had one woman on the faculty, who had principles. You know, most of them were new dealers under FDR. Most of them had either fought in World War II or had served in the United States government in World War II, and just decided, no, enough of war. We had to have a rule of law and human rights and the Constitution. And as you're pointing out, this attitude is becoming extinct in legal education, sadly to say. I guess I'm one of the few remnants of this tradition. I wouldn't send my dog to Harvard Law School these days, and I
All right.